Now, we're going to have Twila Brase with Citizens Council for Health Freedom be on the show, and we're going to show a glimpse, some clips of her talking to her constituents at a rally, and just kind of give you some of the background of Twila and what their organization does. So let's roll the clip.
Well, I like to say that Citizens Council for Health Freedom is all that stands between you and socialized medicine. Now, we have a law today, and it's a socialized medicine law, but it's not yet successful. And it is our intention to make sure that that is always the case. So Obamacare has been set up to dismantle the entire healthcare system from insurance to medical care. The law puts a federal command and control system into place, the exchanges, with HHS as the overseer and the IRS as the enforcer. With the troubled rollout of Obamacare exchanges, you might be tempted to think that the law is on life support. But the fact is, Obamacare is law. We have a national healthcare law, a socialized medicine law in place, and it requires federal agencies to do everything possible to implement it, regardless of how many problems they face. The federal takeover has begun. So we cannot and dare not count on it to simply collapse, which some people are saying, oh, let's just wait for it to collapse. Well, no, it's a law. It will take an act of Congress to repeal it and a president to sign it. And this president has absolutely no intention whatsoever of going in that direction. He may be willing to stand up and try and convince you that he's saying, I'm sorry. But I don't expect you to believe it. And I don't expect him to actually give away his signature act, his legacy. So his goal is single payer, and just because the exchange and its healthcare.gov website are not currently working as planned, that doesn't mean that it won't work splendidly in the future if this law stays on the books. So the exchange is the Obamacare Implementation Center to impose national healthcare nationwide, and they are working night and day to make sure that it works. So.
Well, yes. Twila, thank you for coming on the show. We're glad
you're
to
welcome.
Have you here.
Yep, glad to be here.
And I'm always excited. You know, you're a guest on this show, even though you're not here. Whenever I'm down at the legislature, usually filming some judicial issue mm-hmm. or family law issue, there's usually a hearing going on about health care yep. in Minnesota, and you're usually testifying. So I make sure to film you and play your little speeches and clips on the show.
Great.
Because it's so important for our own freedom and for our health freedom.
Right. Educational.
Absolutely. And so just give us a little description of Citizens Council on Health Freedom.
Well, as I said, we kind of think that we are all that stands between everybody else out there and mm-hmm. socialized medicine. And so what we are doing is we are fighting the government intrusion in the medical decisions between patients and doctors. We're fighting the intrusion of government into our private medical records. And we're trying to preserve the confidential patient-doctor relationship and make sure that we still have doctors around to treat us when we need them, because Obamacare is really going to disincent doctors to stay in the practice, and it's going to discourage students from ever becoming doctors.
Yeah, that's very, very serious business. And now, even before Obamacare came into being, mm-hmm. you had to deal, and you were dealing with a number of issues in Minnesota.
Right.
And what are a couple of those issues you dealt with?
Well, we dealt with we discovered the baby DNA issue.
Okay.
So the baby DNA issue is that states at the time the baby is born, within 48 hours, prick the heel of the baby, take the blood. Actually, the hospital does that, but then the hospital sends it to the state. So here in Minnesota, they send it to the state health department, mm-hmm. and then the health department has laid claim to the DNA of that baby and has shared that with researchers without the consent or the knowledge of the parents. We have changed some of the laws. We have gotten together 9 families who took the health department to court and won at the Minnesota Supreme Court level.
Mm-hmm.
But we are still dealing with it as an issue. Winning does not always mean winning how you would like it to be a win. And right. So there are still issues that we have. The DNA has not been destroyed yet.
Well, that was one of the hearings that I just thought was fascinating, because it's been ordered to be destroyed by the courts and by the statutes, right?
Yes, but apparently they think that there's some wiggle room. So they did testify last session
right.
that they know that they have to destroy it. But it seems to me that they're unclear whether they have to destroy all of the baby DNA or only the baby DNA since the genetic privacy law took effect in 2006. But all the baby DNA that they collected before that didn't have a law, a rule, or anything. They just did it on their own. So I'm not totally certain where everything is, and there is the court case, which is still going through Hennepin County to look for remedies, to see whether there are remedies that for these families. And until it's all over, we won't actually know where everything stands.
It always comes down to motive. And of course they're saying, we're doing this for your good.
Mm-hmm.
We care about you. What's really going on? It seems something more, in my mind, something more sinister.
Well, a long time ago in this country, there was something called the gold rush.
Okay.
And people went where the gold was.
Mm-hmm.
Today, in the 21st century, the gold is in the data. And increasingly, the gold is in the genetic data. So that if you have the DNA of every child, every citizen in this country from birth, and you're a researcher, you can come up with all sorts of reasons why you might be able to get grants from the federal government. Or if you want to deny people access to health care as a health plan or as government, you may be able to use their genetic structure to say why they don't need that, mm-hmm. or why, you know, the future shows that shouldn't happen for them. You know, there are all sorts of ways that data can be used to people's advantage, which is why we say he who holds the data makes the rules. And we believe we as individuals need to reclaim our ownership rights of our medical data and our genetic data and our DNA.
Mm-hmm.
That should be ours, that people do not get to have just because they think it should be public property. And that's exactly what they think it should be. That's what they're arguing for down at the state legislature. That's what they argue for in Congress, that data is not ours. Data is theirs. It's a public property for everybody to use, but it's not.
Hasn't some of this DNA from individuals been sold to other organizations or research facilities without, I mean, if it's my DNA, it's mine. It's my property. I have a property right to that. But yet, my DNA or somebody's DNA is being sold to other research companies and making a profit on that sale, and I had not given any permission for that. Where's
right.
my cut in it? You know, I can say, okay, yeah, go ahead, but you know, let's make a contract here and I get X amount of dollars and, you know, I'll give you a cut for doing the work.
Right. Well, and people might wonder why it is that the health department gets our DNA in the first place. And that's a really good
yeah.
question, because every other test that happens at birth happens in the hospital with the hospital lab, and the health department never gets their hands on it. So they don't get their hands on the mother's DNA, right?
Hmm.
It's just that the newborn screening program got shifted into the health departments, and they have kept it ever since, and then claimed ownership of the DNA and the data, the genetic test results, when it comes in. So Texas, the DNA of babies in Texas, and I'm thinking it was babies in New York, there's like four states where baby DNA got sent to the military to do special sort of race-related research. So they wanted Hispanic blood spots and they wanted black blood spots, the DNA of those colors of children.
Mm-hmm.
And but in Texas, they discovered that the Texas Department of Health had indeed sold DNA in exchange for lab equipment. You know, they'd done bartering. And so this all became part of a lawsuit in Texas. But I'm here to say that it is because our organization discovered this event, started putting out press releases about it, and mm-hmm. a Texas reporter saw the press releases, decided they should figure out what was happening in Texas. And now this has become a big national issue that we have started the conversation on. And even New York, which used to keep all five blood spots, now only keeps one. And if the parents say they want them destroyed, they destroy four of them. But I'm like, well, okay, that's good. But the state's still keeping the baby's
right,
DNA.
Right.
But at least they have started to move in a direction of acknowledging that they have a problem with
mm-hmm.
keeping every citizen's DNA starting from birth and claiming it as government property.
Wow. I see only bad happening from that. But I can see if somebody saying, you know, I want you to have my DNA and give it to the government. I want you to do research on it. Do you have any problem with that?
Well, some people would like that, but my problem with that is that they're likely not going to be told what all the ramifications could be of doing such a thing. And they certainly should not give their children's DNA to the government, because when that child grows up, becomes 18, and they go, really? The government has my DNA and has had it for 18 years. What have they done with it, Mom and Dad?
Have they cloned me?
Yep. Right. What have they done? What do they know about me that even I don't want to know about myself?
Right.
Right. So parents have to think really hard before they give away their child's genetic privacy rights. It's not just for the good of science. That's not what a lot of people are doing it for. And science isn't always good.
No. Right?
So if you do race-related research, some people would find that very objectionable. Some Indian tribes find the whole thing objectionable. So, you know, you have to look at what the research is and decide whether you agree with it or not.
Well, and that's what Nazi Germany was about. All the science that was involved in their testing and the human experiments they did on people was for the good of science.
Right.
And promoting the great race or the whatever race.
Cruel, you know. Cruel experimentation.
Right.
And in this case, the experimentation would happen from afar, right? They take your DNA and then they figure out what's in it. They figure out what you're susceptible to.
Mm-hmm.
They figure out who you shouldn't marry because you'll be expensive for the government and for the health plans. And all of that unbeknownst to you and without your consent over the entire thing.
Yeah. Let's play this next clip. We've already talked about some of these things, but the privacy laws and the baby DNA.
This is all about our campaign to change hearts and minds. If you don't know what's happening, you can't know even what to do. You can't know how to think about it. We achieved 5 major wins at the Minnesota legislature, all related to privacy. We worked specifically with a Democrat chairman who helped us to stop 2 particular bills. One was to conform the state privacy laws to the no privacy HIPAA rule. Minnesota and Iowa are the only states that actually have privacy laws. HIPAA has no privacy whatsoever, no matter what you think. And so we absolutely didn't want that to happen, and he helped us stop it. He also helped us stop a government bill that would have allowed the state health department to store newborn genetic test results longer than the Minnesota Supreme Court would have allowed. And so we stopped that as well. And for those of you who do not know, our organization found the baby DNA issue. We found out that the state governments are collecting the DNA of children, and our efforts around the country have changed what other states do. They have changed what parents do. I heard from a woman, a health department person in Hawaii, who said people are refusing newborn screening in Hawaii because of some person in Minnesota.
Well, that's fun.
Yeah, that's
fun. And to have success with that and giving these parents power over their own children.
Right.
It's amazing.
One thing I would just add is that mothers don't understand that when their baby is tested, it provides the department, the government, a lot of information just about the mother.
Yes, it does.
So, and to a certain extent, the mother is being tested as well, and the information is then known on the mother.
So explain this. And we got a phone call, but we're not going to do it right now. I just got this question, then we'll go to the phone call. Explain this HIPAA. Because, you know, you're when you buy insurance, whether it's health, life, disability, you sign this HIPAA form. And, of course, the thought process is you have privacy then by signing this. But you're saying, no, you really don't.
No. You know, we think that that Congress and the federal government really use this signature to try and convince people that they have privacy. Because, actually, if you sign that form or if you don't sign that form, you have no rights to keep your information private either way. The only what HIPAA does is it gave 2.2 million entities, HIPAA and high tech together, and the high tech was part of the stimulus bill. Okay. So together, 2.2 million entities have access to your medical records without your consent. So people think when they sign the HIPPA form that they have privacy and their information is between them and their doctor. One legislator told me
and
that's exactly what he thought.
And the insurance company, and you're giving a release to say you can go out and get this information from this company. It just stays between this insurance company and the other.
But you're not giving a release at all. All you're saying is that you have read the notice of privacy practices and essentially that you know you don't have any privacy. So if you didn't bother to look at the notice of privacy practices just thinking that it was privacy practices, you wouldn't realize that it's really disclosure practices. They tell you all the ways that they can use your data without your consent. Now, we encourage people not to sign that, and we have special little wallet-sized cards to help people when they go into the doctor's office.
Right.
And I encourage people to do that. I just heard from a woman today who was denied treatment if she didn't sign the form.
Well, that's but can that happen? Is that legal to do?
No, because even HHS on their website says that people do not have to sign the form. It will not protect you at all if you do not sign it. It will not protect you if you do sign it. But the best thing is to not have the clinic come to you after you have learned that your information has been shared the way you didn't want it shared, and you complain, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they bring that little piece of paper to you, mm-hmm. and they say, you signed right here that you read our notice of privacy practices, and therefore you know how broadly we would have shared your data, so you really have no complaint.
Mm-hmm.
So it's better to not let them come and wave that under your nose.
But a doctor saying, sign this, you have to, we won't give you treatment, are they just misled?
Yes.
Is that that's probably the bigger issue. There's no evil intent there. They just don't understand themselves.
They don't understand. They're afraid of being charged with a HIPAA violation. And so just today I told the woman who contacted us from a completely different state, and I said, next time, don't just take in our card. Take in the HHS website where it says, and we have that on the card, but I said, you have to just take in the take in their website where it says they don't have to sign.
Sure, yeah, that's big. Well, okay, caller, you have a comment or question? Thank you for watching the show. Caller, are you there? You got the volume up, Dallas. Must be gone. Okay. Call back. We'll hang you up here, and we'll give it another try. Well, let's get into Obamacare. And, of course, there's great difficulty in launching Obamacare. And there's this lack of access to the Federal Health Exchange website and inaccurate information coming from the website or from the press, and that's all out there. Bad information on subsidies. There's a whole bunch of problems with Obamacare. What do you think is going to be the ultimate fate of Obamacare?
I was going to say, because you're talking about there's a whole bunch of problems with Obamacare, we could sit here for the next many, many hours and talk about the problems with Obamacare. But what people are seeing right now is the website. And 2 days ago, the director of building the website said that the website is 100% finished. Now, they are trying to speed it up because it was only allowing a certain number of people on at a time, and that made it very, very difficult for them, and it's still slowed. But the fact of the matter is, he said the entire system, and people don't understand there's a whole system here. It's not just the website. The entire system has still 30 to 40% that is not built. So all the accounting systems are not built. All the payment systems are not built. So a lot of people have gone on to the website, and those who have managed to get through, they will pick a plan and they'll put it in their shopping cart. And all of us are aware of what shopping carts are, right? But they can't pay for it because the entire payment apparatus is not even
It's not built. Okay.
Right? And so,
wow.
And so when HHS comes, the department comes out and says 106,000 people have registered or have enrolled. What they have said is they have something in their shopping cart. But how many of us have gone to Amazon or wherever we put things in our
shopping cart,
right?
Yeah.
And we may never come back and do anything with them. So
or delete them.
Right, and,
later.
And they may choose not to come and pay. They'll look at the price of those things, and they'll go, you know, I think I'm gonna do the uninsured tax instead. That's so much cheaper. They'll have to take me whenever I'm sick, so why not?
But $106,000? That's nothing.
No, that is nothing. And actually, that is only about $26,000 of them in Obamacare, what they call private coverage, but it's not private coverage. It's all government coverage. That's all you can get in the exchange. You do a federal form. You apply to the federal government. You get whatever the federal government says is available. So you are applying to the federal government for coverage. You're not applying to the insurance company. So they've got about $26,000 in Obamacare, which is the new government program. Mm-hmm. And then they have the rest of them are in Medicaid.
Okay. Oh, well.
Or the ESCA programs or, yeah.
So the other 80,000 didn't even sign up for Obamacare. They just gone to
right.
Yeah, Medicaid.
Right.
Wow.
But of course, none of them have really probably even enrolled because the payment system isn't there, so nobody's paid. So are they really enrolled? I don't think so.
No, they're definitely not. All right, caller, we're going to give it, Oh
my goodness.
That's the way it goes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, to me, the big question here is because, when you watch a cable show or national news, you get what's going on nationally, but you don't really get what's happening in Minnesota with Obamacare. So what is happening in Minnesota with Obamacare? How's it working here?
Well, it's important for people to understand, I think, exactly what Obamacare is and how it functions, because people are thinking, well, there's this website, healthcare.gov, and then they've heard this word exchanges, and they've heard this word marketplace, and then in Minnesota they've heard Minsure. And so, and Minsure's been called a marketplace. But here is how it works. We look at the exchange as a big cyber spider. And the cyber spider has a head, that's the federal government. Mm-hmm. It has a body, which is called the federal data services hub. And then it's got legs. Mm-hmm. And the legs reach down to every state. And they reach to the federal government, and they reach to the state agencies.
Okay.
And those legs are the IT connections, all the computerized network. Mm-hmm. And at the bottom of those legs is a foot. Mm-hmm. And the foot is Minsure. Or the foot is Covered California. Or the foot is Connect, which is in Connecticut.
Okay.
And so it's all of these, quote, state exchanges.
Right.
But really what the state exchange is, it's a dummy terminal into the central server called the Data Services Hub.
Okay.
So what's being created under Obamacare is a national exchange system. Everybody has to follow the same rules. They all have to connect to the Federal Data Services Hub. The Federal Data Services Hub, as soon as you are, you're on your website, Minsure, for instance, you press send, and it pings the hub, the federal hub, and then the hub goes into the state agencies and gathers all this data on you.
Mm-hmm.
And then it goes into the federal agencies and gathers all this data on you. And then it comes up with your profile of your data, like citizenship, social security number, household income, tax status, names of your family members, where you work, what's your wages, all of this stuff that gets pulled up, and then the hub sends it to the brand new federal database called the Health Insurance Exchanges Program.
Okay.
And so this is a national, unlike ever created before, a huge data infrastructure to conduct surveillance on insurance status and to allow the IRS to enforce the mandate if you choose not to get covered or if you are non-exempt, if you don't fit into any of the 9 exemptions, and they have to come after you for the tax.
This sounds more like it's really designed to get into every aspect of your life.
Right.
And this isn't just health. This has nothing to do with health care or health insurance.
Right. And I'll just put this up if this is the right one. This is the right one. So this just gives you an idea of how big, and I realize it's a little bright in there, but they can go to our website. They can go to our website and they can get their own copy of the hub. And so that gives you a picture of the cyber spider, or some people will call it the Obamacare monster.
Mm-hmm. Well, and your website, as you can see on the screen here, is
CCHfreedom.org.
And of course, you're on Facebook and
right?
Twitter.
Yep. Okay. Yes, where I tweet.
I'm not there yet.
you can find us at CCH Freedom, or you can do my name, Twila Brase, TWILABRASE.
And if you go to the website, you'll find it all there.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
All the connections and everything that
right.
need to be. This is really nationalism. This is really socialism, in a sense. I mean, that's where they're going. And
I think they're going to single payer, but what you have to do when you see the exchange and you think about a dummy terminal in every state, and right now it didn't work like Obama wanted it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because he had to create healthcare.gov for 36 of the states who said, no, we don't want to build
right.
a dummy terminal.
Right.
Right? But what you have to see is what he really is creating here is what I call a single seller system.
Right.
So that
okay.
there would be only one place in the entire state where eventually people could get coverage. That would be the only place. Insurance outside the exchange would be gone because of the subsidies inside the exchange. People would flood the exchanges, stay out of the insurance companies outside the exchanges. And eventually, once everybody has only their state exchange to go to,
mm-hmm.
then it's very easy to go from single seller to single payer, where the federal
right.
government then pays the exchange to divvy out the money throughout the state.
Well, isn't that the talk that they're trying, or the real effect of Obamacare was to make it not work so we can go to this single seller
right.
system?
Well, there certainly has been conversation. There was even conversation about that when Hillary
right.
tried her plan. So, you know, what's actually in their minds or exactly how they're figuring out, we don't know. But what we know is that we can see the monster that they're creating. What the exchange does is it allows the federal government to reach into every state and control health care
mm-hmm.
in that state. That's why we call the exchange system the Federal Takeover Center.
Mm-hmm.
We also call it the Wealth Redistribution Center.
Mm-hmm.
Because everybody who goes in there, they really want the young and they want the healthy. And then they're charging all of us for things we don't need, like
right.
like they're charging you for maternity coverage.
Yes,
right?
Well, I want to be an experiment in that, so I can understand that.
No. But the reason that they do that is to jack up the price of your premium so that you are paying more, and that's a wealth redistribution because
right.
they know you'll never use it.
Right.
And so you have all this extra money you have paid in that you'll never tap into, and they can then shift to other people. So it's this huge wealth redistribution scheme within the exchange.
So Minnesota has, I'm hearing, spend about $150 million on this exchange. Have you heard any numbers in that regard? Or
yep, that's what they have gotten in federal grants, and they to maintain it.
Okay.
Through I think the end of next year.
Mm-hmm.
The end of next year, every exchange has to be self-sustaining by law.
Okay.
If it is not self-sustained, then it will, and that means it doesn't have enough enrollees. So if it doesn't have enough enrollees, it will fold.
Right.
Unless a state decides to come up with the $60 million or more in operating expenses every year. It's only going to start out at $60 million a year. Some of the prices, if they get more people in it, end up to be in the hundreds of thousands of dollars
mm-hmm.
per year. I'm sorry, $100 million or $200 million mm-hmm. to run the thing.
Well, so if it folds, then what happens?
Then that is the way to get rid of Obamacare. That's why we have
okay.
a refuse to enroll campaign,
okay.
which is encouraging people to refuse to enroll in the exchanges. And they should do it for several reasons. They should do it because they don't want the federal government to take over healthcare,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
But they should also do it because this is the largest consolidation of personal information in the history of the Republic. That's what it said in USA Today. Somebody who has looked at it in depth. And so, and mm-hmm. of course, the security experts just testified in front of Congress that this thing is, that hackers are already trying to get into this
right.
thing, that it has no security, that it should be shut down because it never was built on the foundation of security.
Mm-hmm.
It's got so many holes. So identity theft, fraud, all the stuff that you're exposed to in the exchange, but also the high prices that you're going to pay, mm-hmm. and the fact that it's not private insurance, and the fact that they have narrow network coverage. Mm-hmm. Narrow network means you have few places that you can go. So you might want this doctor, but that doctor's out of network, but you might want this medication, and that's in the network. Mm-hmm. Well, what are you going to pick, your medication or your doctor?
Yeah.
You know, or the hospital that you want, or the doctor you want, if you have to choose between them. Right, that's narrow network coverage. So these are ways to ration healthcare, and that's what they'll be used for.
Okay, how many people in Minnesota have signed up for?
Yes, I'm going to just try and come up with those numbers, and I'm going to be very wrong with those numbers. I know that there's something like 50,000, but I can't tell you whether that's attributed to the Medicaid program. I believe that's okay. In the Medicaid and SCHIP program. Or the expansion Medicaid program, I think it's much less in the Obamacare. It seems to me like it might have been 2,000, could be 5,000.
Yeah,
but it is
I kind of heard that around that 5,000.
But again, as far as I know, nobody has paid.
Well, and they haven't paid, so they spent $550 million grant money for 5,000, give them benefit of doubt, people. So it's about $30,000 a person, just for administrative costs. Mm-hmm. $30,000 a person.
So far. Yeah.
How many do they expect in Minnesota to sign up?
Yes, I think 1 million. I think 1 million was what they were eventually hoping to serve. Eventually.
Okay.
So yes, it's a lot of money. They have no idea whether it will happen. And of course, our campaign with the billboards and the mm-hmm. bus stop posters and our flyer that's mm-hmm. online and our opt-out declaration, all of that is meant to tell people why they should refuse
right.
to enroll.
Right. Well, let's run the clip here. Don't sign up, and then we'll have that whole discussion on what do we do now? You know, what can we do?
We also have initiated a national refuse to enroll campaign with billboards, bus stop posters, flyers, and opt-out declarations, all to educate the public on why they should absolutely not go into the exchanges. The more people they get into the exchanges, the more they can implement socialized medicine across the country. They need the enrollees, and they need the money that comes with those enrollees. They need that to keep the exchanges alive. So this is why we want to keep people out of the exchanges. We want to let them know what this really is, which is a takeover of the healthcare system. Now, our Refuse to Enroll campaign ended up being discussed on CNN, in the Star Tribune, the Washington Post, and the Wall Street Journal, to name just a few. And even The Daily Show with Jon Stewart called and asked for an interview.
you rabble-rouser. Really creating quite consternation for some people. And so this refusing to enroll is pretty significant thing. And,
right.
But a lot of people are afraid of the government. But you figured out a number of ways where you can refuse to enroll or things to do to stay out of this system.
Right.
So
many reporters that I talk to say that our organization is encouraging people to not obey the law.
Okay.
Right? But then I have to explain to them both the Constitution, the U.S. Supreme Court decision, and the law.
Okay.
So the U.S. Supreme Court
explain
said...
to us.
Yeah. So the U.S. Supreme Court said that none of us have to be insured. So we could have the entire nation uninsured, and it would be wholly constitutional.
Right.
So nobody has to purchase health insurance, and that means nobody has to go into the exchange. It means nobody has to get Obamacare in the exchange. It means nobody has to be on Medicaid, Medicare, anything. Nobody has to be.
Okay.
And so we're not telling people not to follow the law. We're telling them that there are opportunities to do something outside of the exchange.
Which is a fundamental issue for our country and our former government, is this freedom and not being forced to do something against our wills.
Right.
And this is also a form, and this is what I don't hear being talked about very much. We have freedom of association in this country, and this is forcing associations with people. making us pay for behaviors that we may not agree with. Mm-hmm. And but I may not agree with a behavior, but I may help pay for somebody who's engaged in whether it's lifestyles or well, say drunkenness, and they've wrecked their life. But I may on my own go and say, you know, you as an individual, I care about you. I want to help you defeat your alcoholism, and I will help pay for that. But what's happening now is this really getting forced on everybody. So people that didn't have medical coverage for alcoholism because they don't drink now have to pay for it, and they really end up supporting a lifestyle that they don't really want to support.
Well, and that's true, but I don't actually think that's the whole purpose of the law. I think that the purpose of the law is because healthcare, socialized medicine, is considered the crown jewel of socialism. Mm-hmm. So if you want to take people's rights away from them, if you want to, or if you want to win elections. See, I think part of this is all about winning elections, saying okay, that we have covered everybody, we've given people health security. It doesn't matter that, yes, they have a card, it says that they're covered. They just don't know yet that being covered doesn't mean that they get access to care.
Right.
Right, because care and coverage are not the same thing at all.
Right.
Right, and so Obamacare, the way it's written, gives a lot of leverage to a lot of bureaucrats, a lot of unelected folks to decide what we can and cannot get, even though we're all covered. Mm-hmm. And so when I look at the law, I say it's not about health care. It's about taking control. And when you take control of people's health care, you take control of people's lives.
All right. So the Supreme Court says, do as you please. So what are the
other? The only thing is that Chief Justice Roberts twisted himself into a pretzel to come up with a tax that exists nowhere in the law. And so we call it the uninsured tax.
Okay.
So there are three alternatives for people. One is to get coverage outside of the exchange.
Okay.
And private coverage outside of the exchange through their employer, through themselves, go to a broker, you know, go to a private exchange. Mm-hmm. You know, there are a variety of options. The second legal option is to claim one of the 9 exemptions. People who are Christians, for instance, can be part of health sharing organizations,
okay,
where the members share each other's expenses. And people who have gotten mm-hmm. sick have gotten hundreds of checks in the mail to pay their bills, and the mm-hmm. bills come down to the cost, an uninsured cost, because they aren't insured.
Right.
So the bills come down to what the bill should be, what the real cost is, okay, and then all the members help to pay those bills.
Okay.
And if you're in an Indian tribe, you're exempt, and there are, as I said, 9 exemptions, and they're right on our homepage down at the right-hand corner.
So again, go to, there we go. Is this it here?
And these are the alternatives, right? And so the third alternative is to go uninsured and pay the uninsured tax. And for a lot of people, they're going to look at that as the most reasonable option. Mm-hmm. Because as opposed to the really expensive Obamacare premiums that mm-hmm. are going to be coming out now inside and outside of the exchange, the uninsured tax costs you $95 the first year, or 1% of your income. By 2016, it's $695, or 2.5% of your income.
Mm-hmm.
But the premiums that people are looking at today are scary. So a lot of people don't get sick. That's why we have insurance, and that's why it's there to cover the catastrophes. If you don't pay all that money for Obamacare-type insurance, you can save a lot of money that you could save for yourself to pay cash or become part of one of these health-sharing organizations and cover yourself and not let somebody else have all this money every year again and again and again. I mean, why pay $10,000 or $20,000 a year,
no,
never go to the doctor? Do you know there's a statistic that says that men between the ages of 21 and 35 go to the doctor 6 times on average?
Okay.
So how much do you want to pay every year?
No, why not just have a major
medical policy
medical
that
policy
you put in a drawer and you forget
good
about it until you have a coma or a
yeah
car crash or something?
Yeah. Okay. Well, so those are 3 legal ways.
Yeah.
And there's a number of options in those 3 legal
right
ways. Of course, there's, well, let me ask you this. Go to this issue here first, and then are there non-legal ways?
That's
kind of what's in my mind here. Canceled insurances. I had a friend, his premium went way up, and then they dropped him. You know, I mean, he couldn't afford it. But I don't remember what happened first, or whether they just eventually had to drop him. You know, and he could afford it, he could pay it, and then they just had, they just dropped it anyway. So in Minnesota, do we know how many policies about have been canceled or dropped? Or
no, dropped as a result of Obamacare. It is, I believe, in excess of 100,000. I was thinking it might be, it's either 114 or 140,000 policies.
Wow.
But that is not the end of it. And just yesterday, or I think it was just yesterday, they came out with a study that says that people who are employees of small businesses, they expect somewhere between 50 and 100 million policies to be canceled. We're only at the beginning of the cancellations. And as you recall, President Obama said, if you like your plan, you can keep it.
Right.
And now he's trying to couch and say, well, I meant if it fit what Obamacare said. Well, that is not what he said. And there is, there's one website that has all of his statements, I think like 38 times, everywhere that they took place. And clearly he has no if clause in any of those statements.
No, he doesn't. Let's play this clip, the There's Hope clip. It's the last one there, because we're running out of time. That's just so, like you said, there's so much to talk about, and we're just scratching the surface here. That's why you go to the website.
There are some serious, wonderful reasons to be hopeful. 4 years after it was signed into law, it is still not settled law. We're still having a national debate, much to Obama's chagrin. Several lawsuits are moving forward, and there's growing angst in Congress as the full ramifications begin to emerge just in time for the 2014 elections. Here's a fact. Obamacare will be repealed. But it's going to take you and me and a whole platoon of people who absolutely refuse to give up, who absolutely refuse to say, oh well, I guess it's law, what's the next thing that we should fight against? No, that's why we're having this event, that's why you're here tonight. The whole plan here for our organization is we must keep up the momentum. We must keep the national debate going in the right direction. Right now, President Obama is a very unhappy man.
Good.
And the Democrats are very unhappy because they're looking at 2014 and they're wondering, will I get back into office? Everyone who signed that bill, everybody who made a vote, took a vote yes and said yes to that bill, the American people have every good reason never to put them back into office again.
Very, very good reasons to not put them back into office. So there is hope, but you know, the House has tried to defund Obamacare continually, and of course that led to the shutdown. But essentially, there's going to have to be Republican control of the Senate. Yes, but we got to really wait till Obama's out of office.
Yes, but I will say that there is an article in National Journal which is very interesting, talking about, of course, how the Democrats are heading towards the hills, and they're trying to come up with ways.
Well, just the ones that are running for re-election, other ones aren't.
That's right.
So which really tells you the real motive is this is just a game.
That's right. It's all about getting reelected. But depending on how many shoes continue to fall, it's entirely possible that the Democrats, to save their political skins, could actually decide that they, too, want a repeal bill. And then knowing, of course, that the president is never going to sign it, then it would come to whether or not the Democrats were willing to help the Republicans override his veto. And the vote that they had on the You Can Keep Your Health Plan bill, the Republican bill, where they got 39 Democrats,
right?
They had about, I thought it was 64 point some percent of the House. They only need two-thirds to override the veto. So they were very close. So
we do not know what the future could be. Okay. In 2 years, or well, the next election could change all that, and there would have to be a veto override.
That's right.
Well, it takes diligence on all of our parts, to get what we need to have, and especially liberties at stake here.
Yep.
Absolutely, and our privacy. This is a big invasion coming on us in my mind in many areas, not just the healthcare. All right, thanks for watching. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. Get out there, do something. God bless. Have a great week. Thank you, Twila, for being on the show.
Yeah, thank you.
All right.
Days gone.